Bienvenue à l'école doctorale Culture et Société de l'Université Paris-Est. Donc pour cette journée d'études du séminaire Littérature et théorie dans les espaces francophones et américains, regard croisé sur le transfert culturel, qui est un séminaire que nous assurons avec Papa Samba Diop du laboratoire LIS. Avec cette journée, donc à partir et autour du transfert culturel, on se propose de réfléchir au redéploiement des enjeux méthodologiques, scientifiques, mais aussi politique des disciplines dans le domaine des lettres, des langues, des arts, des sciences humaines et sociales. Donc ce qui est en jeu, c'est l'espace. C'est l'espace entre une ou plusieurs cultures, entre un ou plusieurs objets, une ou plusieurs disciplines. L'espace en tant qu'il est prédéterminé ou non, et surtout l'espace en tant qu'il peut être transformé. Donc autour des conférences plénières de Louis et Jane Gordon de l'Université du Connecticut, que je remercie très très chaleureusement d'avoir traversé l'Atlantique spécialement pour cette occasion, nous allons avoir des présentations par des doctorants et des jeunes docteurs qui ont travaillé cette thématique à partir de leur propre recherche doctorale. Donc c'est une approche de la transversalité, du transverse qui se fait par le biais du transfert culturel et qui aussi donc touche la question de la transculturalité et de la transdisciplinarité. Et c'est en fait une approche qui est très concrète. Parce que ce à quoi elle tient ou ce à quoi elle ressortit, c'est la mise en relation de ces recherches doctorales avec d'autres objets, d'autres méthodes, d'autres disciplines que celles des doctorants et jeunes docteurs réunis. Donc il s'agit pas d'opposer à la discipline ou à la nanodisciplinarité ou à la monodisciplinarité la transdisciplinarité, hein, c'est pas une opposition stérile, mais ça se présente plus comme une possibilité, la possibilité d'un espace, l'espace d'une mise en relation critique et réflexive. Alors je passe tout de suite la parole à Yannick Bleck, qui est doctorant des laboratoires Imagé et LISA, et qui travaille sur l'écrivain africain-américain William Melvin Kelly, et sur la conceptualisation de l'identité et l'expérience vécue, le rapport entre identité, conceptualisation de l'identité et expérience vécue. Yannick Bleck qui va donc présenter le travail de Louis Gordon.
Merci beaucoup. Donc, bonjour à tous. Nous avons aujourd'hui le plaisir d'accueillir Louis Ricardo Gordon de the University of Connecticut, comme l'a dit M. Rocky, où il est professeur de philosophie, d'études africaines, américaines et juives. Parmi ses domaines d'expertise, on peut citer, outre la religion, les religions plutôt, la philosophie africana, c'est-à-dire l'ensemble des pensées philosophiques qui s'attachent à étudier et à comprendre les enjeux concernant les personnes africaines et celles d'ascendance africaine. La philosophie africana inclut également l'ensemble des philosophies produites et concernant les Africains, les personnes d'origines africaines et toute personne travaillant à la reconnaissance de la philosophie africana. Phénoménologue et existentialiste, Louis R. Gordon prolonge une longue tradition philosophique et humaniste noire de W.E.B. Du Bois et Zora Neale Hurston à Frantz Fanon, d'Aimé Césaire à C.L.R. James ou Paget Henry, et dans leur sillage, s'interrogent sur les conditions d'existence des Noirs et les enjeux existentiels que sont la liberté, l'angoisse, la responsabilité, le libre arbitre, le caractère social et la libération. Gordon est l'auteur de, entre autres, Fanon and the Crisis of European Man, An Essay on Philosophy and the Human Sciences, Her Majesty's Other Children, Sketches in Racism from a Neo-Colonial World, Bad Faith and Anti-Black Racism, paru chez Humanity Books en 1999, Existential Africana, Understanding African Existential Thought, Disciplinary Decadence, Living Thought in Trying Times, et What Fanon Said, A Philosophical Introduction to His Life and Thought, qui sera publié cette année chez Fordham. Vous pouvez, comme l'a dit M. Rocky, consulter plusieurs de ses ouvrages sur le présentoir à l'entrée. Le travail de Lewis Gordon commence d'être traduit en France, où il a donné plusieurs conférences et où il a organisé, notamment en 2007, un cycle de colloques à la Maison des sciences de l'homme de Paris, un cycle consacré au racisme, à l'antisémitisme et à l'islamophobie. Dans la philosophie qu'il développe, Lewis R. Gordon se concentre en particulier sur le fait de repenser l'humanité noire dans un monde qu'il a déshumanisé tout au long de son histoire. Cela signifie une conceptualisation des existences noires et particulièrement celles issues de la diaspora africaine. Repenser l'existence noire n'est pas cédé à la tentation essentialiste. Comme la philosophie africana qui la formalise, c'est une activité intellectuelle, inclusive et transculturelle. Ce qui fait qu'elle ressortit à la philosophie africana est moins conditionné par l'être noir du penseur-chercheur lui-même qu'à sa bonne distance vis-à-vis de son objet. La distance qui ne reproduit pas dans la méthode la déshumanisation mondaine. Puisque ce dont il s'agit est de connaître le sujet en tant qu'être humain, et non pas en tant qu'objet, mis à distance par l'étude et par le chercheur. La complexité de l'humain est en ce sens au cœur d'une pratique des sciences humaines qui ne peut ainsi pas être réduite et cantonné dans un champ disciplinaire, à l'exclusion de tous les autres. La recherche de Lewis R. Gordon est donc transversale à plusieurs disciplines, comme il le dit lui-même dans une interview de 2012. Je cite, « Une des choses qui lie tout mon travail est le fait que tout ce que je fais et tout ce sur quoi j'écris revient à cette question de ce que signifie être humain. » Bien que mon doctorat soit en philosophie, c'est une question qui traite vraiment de la condition humaine. Mon travail a donc un impact dans ce que l'on pourrait appeler les sciences humaines. Fin de citation. Par nature, et en lien avec la pensée qu'il développe, Gordon est par conséquent un philosophe transdisciplinaire. Ses écrits sont, à l'image de ses publications, emprunt d'une pensée transversale, d'une pensée du transverse qui ne cherche pas à circonscrire un savoir monolithique, calcifié, une tour substantialisée, dirait Fanon, mais qui privilégie le transfert, le flux, la circulation, la mise en résonance des connaissances pour mieux appréhender les dimensions identitaires et culturelles. Épistémologique et politique de son objet d'étude que ne sauront le faire les disciplines quand elles se coupent les unes des autres. Gordon insiste également dans son travail sur la décolonisation du savoir, un savoir
héritée de l'eurocentrisme et de la colonisation, et que prolonge aujourd'hui les conditions sociales, politiques, épistémiques de sa production. Le moyen en est de redéfinir la géographie de la raison et d'en déplacer l'épicentre, la Caraïbe, pour Gordon qui, comme Fanon, avant lui, dans son projet de désaliénation du noir et du blanc, oppose l'humanité et la raison des Noirs à la rationalité absolutisée qui a servi la déshumanisation et la domination, à la décadence disciplinaire contemporaine qui en est la résurgence et le symptôme. Il y a par conséquent une remise en cause des méthodes, à l'instar de Fanon qui, dans « Peau noire, masque blanc », remet en cause l'humanité de l'homme noir, non pas en tant qu'humain, mais parce qu'elle n'est prise qu'à l'aune de celle de l'homme blanc. Fanon veut une reconnaissance de l'homme noir pour ce qu'il est, sans comparaison avec les valeurs du groupe blanc dominant. Pour dépasser cette décadence disciplinaire, par laquelle les disciplines rejettent toute approche leur étant a priori exogène, une décadence qui entretient le racisme néocolonial et empêche la transformation sociale, Lewis Ricardo Gordon propose une critique de la méthode dont la colonne vertébrale est ce qu'il appelle la suspension téléologique de la disciplinarité. C'est le sujet de la conférence qu'il va maintenant donner et qui est intitulée « Decolonizing Knowledge, Norms, Methods and Disciplinary Decadence ».
Merci Yannick.
De rien.
Et Jean-Paul.
You need the mic.
Best one, the mic. So, bonjour. Shalom, salam alaikum. Et depuis, je suis jamaïcain. How you keeping? Alors maintenant, je pars ma présentation en franglish. D'accord? C'est anglais, un peu français. Parce que je ne ferai pas violence on the French language. So I'll speak at this point in a very friendly English. So thank you all for coming out on this glorious freezing French morning. It's funny, it's the temperature is colder in Connecticut where we're coming from, but it feels colder here, which raises certain interesting questions. I'll begin first with I've been thinking about my first book. It was written 20 years ago. It was Bad Faith and Anti-Black Racism, Mauvaise Foi, okay? And in that book, I argued something that continues to today. There is racism, that we know. There's anti-black racism, that we know. But when I wrote that book, at the time, I didn't realize I was challenging how we write about human beings. You see? When you think about mauvaise foi, in the English, it's bad faith. And to bring the word bad into anything makes people look away from it. But what they didn't understand is that I wasn't being moralistic. You see, bad faith, mauvaise foi, is about something complicated in human reality, which is the human ability to lie to ourselves. The human ability to attempt to escape things we don't like. the human ability to reach for a pleasing falsehood and to run away from a displeasing truth. Now, I had no idea at the time that that theme actually affects a lot of ideas. One of them is something observed by Frantz Fanon. Frantz Fanon in Pour Noir Masque Blanc said he noticed that reason had a habit of leaving a room when a black person walks in. But it struck me that he was talking about more than reason. You see, he was also talking about something that infects thought. Many of us learn how to think in a strange way. We think thinking is like a battle, and you're going to go on the battlefield and knock down the opponent, and you win the argument. Because if you knock down the opponent and you're the last, usually, man standing, now the world is clean, it's pure, and all is right. So there's a connection between force, purity, and notions of right. The problem, though, is, as we know, somebody else could come and knock you down the road. Someone could come along and challenge the very idea that there's only one way to do things. And we begin to realize there are other ways to think. And another way to think is to attempt to develop a relationship with others' thinking. So the goal is not to knock down others, but to figure out together how the relations work. That really is the spirit of phenomenology. But it's more than that. You see, when I began my career, I realized I did something that many people didn't do. I didn't write through asking myself what my discipline was. Instead, I looked at the problem and asked myself, what do I need to address this problem? And it began to occur to me that if I started as a philosopher, everybody had a theory of how I should be a philosopher. People said you should be a philosopher like the Anglo-American analytical philosopher. You should be a philosopher like the hermeneutical, the Gadamerian Ricoeur philosopher. Are you a Heideggerian philosopher? Are you a Sartrean philosopher? There were all these philosophers I'm supposed to be, as if they had the answers to everything, or I simply had to know which philosopher was going to be my colonial master. And so early on, I saw the problem that is part of my presentation, that part of the colonization of knowledge is to make you begin by asking which knowledge system you're going to subordinate yourself to. Under whom do you, well, sit? But even more, what was interesting was, in case some of you may not have noticed, I'm black. And so it was fascinating that it's not only was I asked which discipline to subordinate myself to, but the physical manifestation of the discipline came down to a simple question. Which white man will be my master? Now, anybody who knows me know I don't like masters. In fact, it's funny, in my travels, everywhere I go, communities give me a local name. I was very happy to be in Corsica, to have my Corsican name, Luigi. Recently, I was in Kenya, and seeing how I'm behaving this morning, I'm normally a certain way. I was given a local name, which is Lemayan, right, among the Maasai. And it's funny, that name also meant the same thing as Louis. Because Louis and Luigi mean warrior, blessed warrior. So when I start with a critique of fighting, it's not that I think you should never fight, but you should understand the era of a certain way of fighting. In Bad Faith and Anti-Black Racism, I identified the problem of philosophical anthropology. That how we define who or what we are establishes our relationship to what we think, what we do. And in fact, the error that many people made when they would study anti-black racism or racism is they thought the philosophies could simply be applied to the study of race and racism. But they never asked the question, what if the philosophies were racist? What if the philosophies were colonial? And this, of course, is very insulting to many philosophies and philosophers, because one imagines philosophy as universal, unprejudiced, and free. The problem was that every time one imagined what was universal, unprejudiced, and free, it always took the form of a white man. And it's not that white men were trying to say it had to be white men, but something that happened in the world that created that, and that was coloniality. The error many people made was they didn't understand that colonialism was not simply the conquest and the material control of peoples. It was also epistemological. It was at the level of the very production of knowledge. And this is something Frantz Fanon identified in Pour Noir Mess Blanc, but not only Fanon. Antoine Fermin in Haiti in 1885, in this city, well, nearby in Paris, in the center, he right there went to a meeting on anthropology. He was part of the French Ethnology Society, and every paper that he went to explained that black people cannot think. So you have to imagine, what is he to do? He's a black man in a room where papers are to tell him he is incapable of thinking. So Antoine Fermin produced The Equality of the Races, a tome, a big book in which he took on in 1885 many of the issues of disciplines, many of the issues of philosophy, geography, all of those things that we look at today. W.B. Du Bois did this. And even when I went further, I wrote a book called An Introduction to Africana Philosophy, where I look at more than 1,000 years of scholarship on addressing these issues. So you have this problem. thought as universal and as pure says it captures reality. However, when you look at the world from the perspective of blackness, you see many things that are not addressed. So, in effect, what I began to notice in my early writings was that there is a black side of thought. And when I say a black side of thought, I don't mean racial. What I mean is something more radical, which is that thought, when it collapses into becoming pure, sees itself as eliminating all contradictions. Okay? Now, although you can create a law as the elimination of all contradictions, the human world is a world of negations. So what happens? I usually put it in concrete language this way. If you try to maximize consistency, if you try to make your theory pure, it means there is nowhere in the theory that there could ever be a contradiction. But now you look at a human world. And I usually put it this way. Would any of you in this room like to be married to, date, go out, or spend the rest of your life with a maximally consistent person? You know what that is. The word is hell. Okay? So what is going on? Well, you see, Mauvais Foi tapped into something crucial. There is a naive world. If you speak to many children, for instance, children would say, when they encounter an inconsistency, that isn't fair. Why did the rules change? But what adults know is that adults, when you are responsible for rules, it means not only knowing rules, but knowing when to break them. And this is what drives philosophy, theory, nuts. It drives them crazy. Because if you think about what theory is, and theory's origins, by the way, are theological. The word theo is in theory, it means God. Theory means trying to see God's point of view. But how do you see God's point of view in a godless universe? And this is where the problem comes in, because you see, when you think of God's point of view, God is omniscient. God could see everything. So God, it seems, experiences no contradiction. So when we attempt to be like God, we try to imitate God and eradicate contradictions. But that is the contradiction, because we're not gods. So the question is, how do you do theory when you're a human being? And this is one of the things I noticed from that first book that animated, that affected a lot of what I wrote after. Because you see, bad faith, mauvaise foi, also attempts to create completeness, control. It says anything outside is wrong and everything inside is complete. And at that point, I began to notice something, that there are what I called coextensions, which is different forms of bad faith, different ways in which we try to pretend we are gods, pretend we are the world. Racism, for instance, makes one group of people function like gods and other group of people below them to be like not even animals. Because I have to tell you, you all know this, in a racist world, animals are actually higher than the people who are considered racially inferior. In fact, in some of my writings, I've argued that what racism has done is changed the meaning of an animal. You know, there are people who are less afraid of a lion, a crocodile, or a rat than they are of a black person walking through their neighborhood. The real wild today is a category of people outside of people. And so this led to noticing something crucial. The philosophical anthropology is in trouble when it attempts to eliminate relations. A godlike anthropology says, I am the world. A different anthropology says the human being is a relationship, which means each relationship is understood in terms of other relationships. This means then to talk about subjects, whether they are women, whether it's sexuality, whether it's even an abstraction like gender, class, race, is not to talk about things, but to talk about relationships that produce meanings. This then led to three categories: philosophical anthropology, discourses on freedom, because we're talking about changing subjects, and the object of this meeting, this conference, this Congress. The last one I argue is how do we justify even justification? Now, the way I have been speaking is what we call meta-theory. It's the theory about theory. And the meta-theory, and this is something that Frantz Fanon and many others paid attention to, is how does even justification justify itself? And many philosophers hate that question. But I have argued that any discipline must be able to answer that. Because you see, there's a way you could justify yourself that is unfortunately a collapse into decadence. Decadence is when something begins to die. If you look at the way disciplines are constructed, disciplines begin the way I began that first book, which is there's a problem and you need to develop a way of addressing the problem. That produces methods, techniques, and ways of looking at it, and you begin to build relationships across disciplines. You begin to communicate and create ideas. However, something has happened to many disciplines in the academy, and you all know this. What has happened to many disciplines has been what I've called disciplinary decadence, but you could see it better when I talk about, in the piece I sent, the fetishizing of method. This is where, just as when I started my writing, people are not interested in what you say. They're not interested in whether what you say reveals a better relationship to reality. They're not interested in any of that. They're simply interested in your method. And in your method, they're not interested in how your method produces knowledge. They're interested in how you obey the rules of the method. That is the fetishizing of method. It's when method turns you away from reality. Okay? Now, there are many examples of this, but the main one is when the method becomes the identity of the discipline. When that happens, then a special kind of bad faith or mauvais foi emerges. And you all know these examples because this room has people from different disciplines. But the experience of it is when you meet the scientist, the natural scientist, the biologist, the chemist, the physicist who may say to the person who does literature, you're not scientific. And then you have the literature fighting back, the literature scholar. The literature scholar looks at the scientist and says, you're not textual. All right, so you get textual fetishism. You know what that's about. All right, the text becomes the world. But then you get the philosophers, depends on which kind of philosopher, who says, you're not logical. But you know, one of the interesting things in phenomenology is that phenomenology dared question even phenomenology. Phenomenology was willing not to worry about being logical because it had to question logic. It decided not to worry about being phenomenological because it had to question phenomenology. And when this happened, the question is, if you're going to avoid being decadent, what do you do? Well, you could already see that the way I talked about the black side of thought is connected to this insight that reason is broader than rationality. Rationality attempts to be consistent. Reason, in its effort to evaluate rationality, has to be willing to deal with paradox and contradiction. And so once reason takes this path, where is it disciplinarily? Well, what's interesting is that it now begins to look at the relationship across disciplines. And I call that transdisciplinarity. It is not interdisciplinarity, because interdisciplinarity, each discipline comes to the table as if it is complete. And if you're complete, why do you need to listen to the other discipline? In fact, it becomes what Husserl argued in terms of philosophy. Each discipline comes in the room, but they don't communicate. And that means each discipline imagines itself to be reality, to be the world. And what is lost in that attitude is, in fact, the world. So the black side of thought, interestingly enough, is the realization that reality is greater than any discipline. And you could see why the black side of thought creates anxiety. Because thought in the old model is like a man who wants to have complete control. You see? But suddenly, he's encountering that which he cannot control. And that's why you could see a lot of the early metaphors of a lack of epistemic control often was gendered. It's the woman you couldn't control. And the feminine was projected onto the blackness you cannot control. And of course, if you can't control them, it gets to the sexuality you cannot control. And as you begin to look at it, you begin to realize that the old style of looking at, say, sexuality, gender, race, all these anthropological categories as secondary to the real human subject are false. That actually we need theoretical models that manifest the relationships across these. And this means that our meta theory, our theory about theory, has the potential to be more radical than many of us expect. And this is now where a lot of my work is at now, and I think can connect to what many of you do. I'm just going to close with three examples. The first one is connected to what Yanni pointed out, the geography of reason. Although empires existed before what we call the Euro-modern empire, we often forget that there didn't used to be a Europe. There didn't used to be an Africa. There didn't used to be the arrangement of the world as we have it now. But if you look at previous empires, all empires have something in common. Every empire announces itself as the last empire because it is going to be the permanent city, the permanent site of power. The Roman Empire was to be forever. The Greek Empire forever. Egyptian empires forever. Spanish empires, so forth. The British Empire was to be forever. The British still think they have an empire. And now in the United States, if you were to speak in the United States and you say there will be a future when the United States doesn't rule the world, no American believes this. And you know why. You know why. When you live in an empire, the end of the empire is the end of the world. Now, of course, you go to Portugal, you go to Spain, you know, you live here. Life goes on after empire. But the crucial thing is that changes the perception of time. What's unique about this empire, the empire, I'm talking about the Euro-modern empire, is the Euro-modern empire created a new kind of anthropology, a new being. And that being was the notion of the primitive being. What is a primitive? A primitive is supposedly a being that belongs to a pre-time, a time before real time. The problem, of course, is when Columbus landed in Haiti, because that was the original name of the island, and met the Taínos and the Caribs, although they started in Columbus's time of Christendom, the Taíno time, when they met, they were in a new and shared time. They're now meeting in the time of coloniality. And so the legacy of the time of coloniality has within it a meeting of time and space, which makes reason geopolitical. It's not geography in the sense simply of a map. It's not geography simply in the sense of a place. It's geography in the sense of belonging to a world and a time that now creates a paradox. Because you see, that time produced the notion of the primitive, and in it, it also produced the notion of the black, which produced the notion of the white, But the black in that world is a paradox. Because as we know, none of the people who became black in that world were black before. They are indigenous to that temporal world. The problem is that world says they don't belong. So you have a paradox of belonging to a world to which you don't belong. And I call that black melancholia. Right? But this raises an interesting question, because it means that it makes you, in that world, have to look at the world itself. You become a problem of that world. But if you are to examine how that world produces you as a problem, you begin to see that world as a world of shifting relations. And that means that the category blackness becomes a metacritique even of critique. It becomes the difficult task of examining how their new relations will produce other relations. And among them, for instance, I have argued, is that that world produces relations that cannot separate race and gender. Because, you see, the realignment, in the past, the world was separated as masculine and feminine. But what do you do if cross sexes are in the category of the feminine? There was the black as the feminine. And this began to produce new categories of people. It began to produce, for instance, a conception of gender that didn't exist before. And that's why, for instance, this room is part of that world, because the women in this room are a different kind of being than the category of women before that world emerged. But the error people made is, if you look at the old metaphysics was that you could put blacks into that world, you could put women into that world, but keep the world the same. But if I am correct that human beings are relationships, then when you try to put new people into those worlds, you shift the relations of that world. The old order expected what women entering that world to be is to become men in that world. What blacks entering that world were to become is simply whites in black skin in that world. That's what Fanon meant by peau noire, masse blanche. Actually, it was, by the way, Francis Janson who did that title. But the idea was Fanon's. But then you have the obvious question. If you now shift away from primitivism and you realize it makes no sense, that the temporal world that we occupy is a world that shifts relations, then why do we stop at race, women, sexuality, class? Do you see what I'm getting at? There might be more to produce in this anthropology. As we begin to, we in our disciplines, in our practices, begin to communicate. When one discipline really communicates with another, it's not that the discipline stays the same, it's that they may create a new relationship, which may be new disciplines. But there's a difference in a discipline as a closed subject versus a discipline as a possibility. You see? And that I call teleological suspension of disciplinarity. It means you bring a purpose of developing a relationship that takes seriously the discipline isn't complete. You see? And now we get to the closing part that gets very tricky. Everything I talked about up to this point is epistemological. It's about knowledge. It's about how the way we pursue knowledge produces different kinds of beings. And that means, for instance, the human sciences doesn't have this fixed human that you tap science onto. The human sciences are actually participants in the production of human relations. You see? Now, that, believe it or not, it is not that controversial. There are some people who are positivists. They want to stick to the idea that they have their science, they do it their way. There are people who are structuralists who will take seriously relations across structures. That doesn't bother many people. But I began to notice something that bothered me. I got involved with a group of theorists called decolonial theorists. Okay? And decolonial theorists argue that you should decolonize knowledge. That, welcome, Devin. Sure. What? Okay. And so many people are comfortable by saying, reject a Western episteme, or reject, or look at indigenous knowledge, or change economic relations. People are comfortable with that. But it began to strike me as I travel, as I go across the world, I began to notice something very peculiar. You know how I asked for phenomenology to be critical of phenomenology? Radical decolonial studies must ask about the decolonization of decolonial studies. It has to. And when it asks that, it means doing something that brings me back to mauvaise foi. And it means connecting to things like psychoanalysis that I know Jean-Paul Rocky works on. It means connecting to something that some of you who look at Nietzsche may have noticed. And for many of you, it means dealing with something that's difficult in theory. It means asking oneself if one is willing to face one's deep attachments. What is the deep attachment that you may not be letting go of that is blocking the relationship of thought? Now, if you look at decolonial studies, what that is now the question of the normative. It's ethics and justice. You see, decolonial studies will argue against Eurocentrism, can argue against classism and those things, which are correct. But a question I began to ask is, when we struggle, when we fight a decolonizing struggle, Fanon noticed that the decolonizing moment, and this requires a longer discussion, but the short version, is always a violent moment. And in epistemic terms, it's always a form of epistemic violence because something has to be discarded. Something has to be let go. But the post-decolonizing moment faces another problem. The problem it faces is what is its relationship to the decolonizing moment? If it stays trapped in the decolonizing moment, then what it builds, what the discipline builds, what the politics build, what the society builds, is ultimately going to be an ongoing form of violence. Do you see? And so I'm going to make it concrete now, right? I'm giving the abstract argument. Here's the concrete argument. The concrete argument is this. When we move from epistemic decolonization to the question of the decolonization of norms, of values, we often presume that decolonizing values will give us justice, will give us the right norms. But what if, and we don't ask this uncomfortable question, what if one of the colonizing norms is justice itself? Is the conception of morality we have? What if we presume that, just as we presume that the universal is white, and if we go back to that, my argument in a lot of my books is this. When you think white, you think pure, so you don't pay attention to the other relations. When you think black, you don't think pure, you notice white and the other relations, so it means you deal with the contradictions of the society. It's not that black is the universal, it's that in recognizing that the universal lies to itself that it's universal, blackness forces, brings on a universalizing practice. So now we come to this question. Is justice a universal? People look for universal justice. And what I argue, I began to see as a problem is this. When we look at many other societies, what we call indigenous norms, I'll pick South Africa as an example. When we look at something like Ubuntu, we often think, or if you go to Latin America, you look among the Mamos, people of Colombia, or if you think of concepts like Uhuru, and there are many other concepts, we tend to treat those concepts as if they're like the primitive. They were pre-modern, colonialism came in, and brought universal justice. The problem with that model is it requires a history of colonialism that's like this. You have people, the colonizer comes in, the people stop thinking. In the future, there is a revolution or a decolonizing moment. The colonizer steps back, and the people say, where did we leave off? Do you see the problem? It requires looking at colonized subjects as non-thinking people. However, what if we look at colonialism as a constant dialectical struggle for meaning? Colonizer comes in, people use the norms they had before, they struggle with the new norms of the colonizer is struggling what supposedly are the old norms, and new norms come in, a teleological suspension of norms. Do you see the argument? It means that because the subordinated subjects were trying to figure out the dark side of modernity in at the level of norms, it means those norms are actually another kind of modernity. You see? So instead of saying Euro-modernity with justice, truth, universal, there's also Afro-modernity, indigenous modernity, because those subjects are not in pre-colonial time, they're in this time we are in all together. Whether you're Xhosa, Zulu, Luo, Tokoyo, Nez Perce, Navajo, you're not that Navajo, that Nez Perce, that Xhosa, You are the one of today, 2015. Do you see what I mean? And it means that you represent an, the meeting of norms, the actual, do you know the way I talk about disciplines? The meeting of disciplines and norms that may transcend the mere application of old European norms to the present. We see that today because in many struggles, we don't ask the question, what if justice has been achieved, but humanity needs more than justice? You see? In every example I gave, the philosophical anthropology says the human being is always more. And so perhaps what we need now to deal with the expanding humanity, the humanity that has, it's even the way we talk about sexuality doesn't fit anymore. We've seen it even in our lifetime. They are so radically changing as these relationships change that we may now need a decolonizing practice of norms to deal with the different arrangements of human relations being produced. This expands into the political realm. We're even living in a world in which there's a compression, a pressing in, because there are more people today, 8 billion people. The technologies are different. They move faster. So our conception of time is actually going through a revolution. And the error we're making is we think that we can stay the same while we make these changes around us. But we are changing. And the question is, as we change, if we develop new relations of knowledge, what radically different kinds of disciplines, what radically different kinds of even the notion of process, even the notion of how we think of physical reality, even the notion of how we think of aesthetic life, of feelings, of connectedness, all of that is now in a different way of theorizing, okay? So, to conclude, this is the last part, it means also we're going to have to think about something that has been talked about a lot in France, in French thought, but I think we need to revisit it in a different way given my argument. And the last thing I want to talk about is the conception of power, okay? I'm going to give a very simple definition of power. We know that people talk about biopower, people talk about power all over the place to the point where it's almost as if humanity hates power now. But power, as I'm going to define it, is the ability to make things happen. And when we make things happen, it's the ability and the access to the conditions to make things happen. In a situation where power is brought into one governing body, it often limits the ability of others to make things happen. And this is why the example, if we look back to theory, the crucial mythical example of power has been God. Because if you think about it, God is the being who should be able to make things happen. In fact, I often bring this up. It would be very strange if God showed up. I mean, Jean-Paul left, so if God replaced Jean-Paul. And if God showed up, you know what would be on all of your mind, right? If God sat here, right? We always give God this guy thing, so let's make God she. If she sat here, what's the first thing you're going to ask God to do? In fact, you're going to do that, right? You're going to say, you're God? And she says, I'm God. You know what you're going to say. Do something. And it would be very strange, isn't it, wouldn't it, if God said, I can't. Why? Well, you no longer believe in me, so I can't do anything. But what we have replaced God with has been systems of knowledge, governing bodies, institutions, social relations, and all of these are things that are to make things happen. Do you see what I'm getting at? So all these things are manifestations of power. In the world today, if we have this problem of decadence of power, it means that we are drawing power away from the institutions, the bodies, the people that can make things happen. And when power is taken away from social relations, it means that each of us will be locked in our mere physicality, which means we are only with strength, but we don't have power. Now, I bring this up because it means part of the teleological suspension of disciplines, part of the freeing of knowledge, part of the transformation of norms, is the unleashing the relations that would radicalize the distribution of power. You see my t-shirt, right? Danger, black man, educated black man, and I'm armed with knowledge, right? Well, the idea right now then is to create systems that don't make knowledge come closed inward, don't make norms locked inward, but actually unleash them, not simply from an individual, but the shifting relations that will change the very geography of reason, the very condition through which we understand what it is to be human, what it is to be free, and what it is to engage in any practice of justification, which is a lot of what we do as practitioners of disciplines. I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Was that on time?
Yeah, just on time. Thank you very much, Louis.
I was on time.
So we have a few minutes for a discussion. Une dizaine de minutes pour un échange. Et lorsque vous posez votre question, si vous pouviez, à la demande de l'équipe du campus numérique qui est avec nous et qui enregistre cette session, si vous pouviez vous lever pour qu'ils puissent bien vous voir. Et si vous pouviez aussi, quand vous le pouvez, poser votre question dans les deux langues qu'on utilise, le français et l'anglais. Et si vous ne pouvez pas, on a une fine équipe d'anglicistes qui pourra vous aider à traduire la question. Et ce sera aussi l'occasion peut-être de préciser certains points de la conférence qui vient d'être donnée quand ça s'avère nécessaire. Voilà, pour faciliter la circulation des idées. Voilà. Est-ce que il y a des questions? Any question? Yeah.
Please say your name.
I have a question about, well, thank you first for your talk. I have a question about transdisciplinarity and how relationships happen in transdisciplinary practice. And I wanted to know, how can we be sure that transdisciplinarity is not going to fall again into disciplinary decadence? Because how can we be sure that the disciplines that communicate in transdisciplinary practice are not going to come to the table as complete as it happens with interdisciplinarity?
En français, est-ce que c'est nécessaire de traduire la question en français? Non, ça va pour tout le monde? Ok, très bien. Dites-le clairement, sorry Louis. Dites-le clairement. Hein.
I like to get all the questions, actually, so everybody could get a question in. So if there are more, please ask.
I have one.
Mm-hmm.
mine is about that central notion of theological suspension, and it is actually related to Melanie's question. Since the question I'm having here is the very concrete way to organize that theological suspension, I can understand, theoretically speaking, you know, how you do not predetermine, you know, the results of any given reasoning, you know, but how you put that into form in your research, in doctoral research, in, you know, the type of work we are doing, and also, you know, the very fact that it can be conditioned by the very structure where that suspension is supposed to take place. And then we go back to your, you know, your conclusion about power. In other words, how do you implement, you know, the suspension of teleology within, you know, a system of knowledge production which still functions like an empire, you know? And an empire where, which feeds itself, you know, on the nostalgia and the loss, you know, of the territorial and ethnicized empire, you know. So that's what my question is about.
Okay, more. Yes, please say your name.
Yes, my name is Miriam. My question is actually about the issue of gender that you have mentioned. The fact that you have mentioned black and feminine. So I was just wondering, with regards to the black female body, I wondered, I mean, considered as often, I mean, in terms of hypersexuality of the black female body and current discussions in American society about the difference between feminism and racism and so on. I wondered if decadence could be considered as recreative and productive in some ways, and if you would consider that the creation of new concepts like womanism by Alice Walker to go against white feminism, would you say that this is part of a dynamic of creation of a new discipline? Would all of these go into your theory, really? This is my question.
Thank you. Anybody else? I have a strange brain. I can actually process it all and respond.
I wonder.
No, anybody else?
Yes.
Please say your name.
Yeah, William Dow. Thank you very much for your talk. I'd like to start with that. I have a very simple question. What would be your major criteria for a discipline wanting to justify itself?
Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Well, I begin first with, we have a short time, so you could probably guess I'm condensing what I normally do sometimes over a period of, I've actually been places where I've given like 30-hour lectures where I deal with each of the concepts, okay? So the first thing is, you know that story I told about what happened when this new Euro-modern time emerged? That Euro-modern time emerged, the story of it is told differently in decolonial studies versus the way it's told in much of what's called the Euro Academy. So if you pick philosophy, for instance, modern philosophy begins with a shift to epistemology as first philosophy, and of course the patron saint is René Descartes. Okay? That's the way the story is told. What is not told is who René Descartes' teachers were. And his teachers were Jesuits who were actually in the New World. They were in Dominica. They were people like Suarez,
and others who came back. And so Enrique Dussel pointed out that they left a world of Christendom, which was to be reality, but they suddenly found themselves in a world of people who were not Christian, not Jewish, and not Muslim. And this had to be accounted for. And so what actually in their encounter was the moment of the earth change, the shattering change of philosophy was actually philosophical anthropology. That the philosophical anthropology, to account for it, led to the question of questioning knowledge. You see? However, the way it was transformed in Descartes was not in the relationship of power with through the practice of colonization, but the relationship of self-doubt. Right? Because there was an effort in the continent of Europe to distance itself from the production of difference in the colonies. You see? And so this has been handed down to us methodologically in epistemology, with beginning methodologically with how do you know in advance? You see? So this is addressing it. But the problem is that you can only raise that question if you were a complete mediating subject. And so a lot of the way knowledge began to follow was how to figure out to be that complete mediating subject. The problem, however, is that a human being is always confronting the very basic premise that even asking the question requires an understanding of evidence, evidentiality, which always raises the question of the other. Even to yourself, you imagine yourself as other with evidence. So the epistemology move collapsed on itself when it wanted to be like a god. It had to be humanized as a relationship for evidence to appear. You see? Now, this question of evidentiality and this move away from epistemology, in my writings, I argue against epistemology as first philosophy. And many people think when I do that, they want to know what's the one position who is going to be like the fighter, replace epistemology as first philosophy. But you may have noticed, I did not once present one approach as first philosophy. You notice? I actually argued a relational position. So I talked about philosophical anthropology, its relationship to freedom. Why? Because we're talking about beings that raise the question of possibility, of future. But I didn't stop there. So it's not now a binary. It's not between freedom and knowledge fixed, the way in philosophy, bless you, the way people talk about Heraclitus and Parmenides. I reject that too, and that's why I brought the third element in, the justificatory practices, you see? So these are three relationships. Now, my argument is not that they're three exclusive relationships. That I don't argue we have to limit ourselves to those three. What I argue is that the question of blackness raises those three, because the question of blackness raises the question of, are black people human? It's very difficult to imagine any question about blackness without talking about freedom, about colonizing slave subjects. But the other thing that we know is that blackness always leads to questioning the legitimacy of the subject. Now, a lot of people who do work, if you say black studies, for instance, people want you to justify why do you have black studies. If you say, those of you who are doing black literature, why are you doing it? In fact, a lot of people get upset by it, but I actually argue that's what makes black work healthy. I think all scholarship must answer why it is done. You see? Any kind of disciplinary practice that makes you not have to visit the question of why you do it leads to lazy thinking. It leads to, for instance, I've seen conferences, areas of thought, where there some of the most ridiculous things are taken for granted as first premises. And I'm just like, wait, why do you assume that people believe this? Even in black scholarship, if you think about it, there's some people who take as a first premise to study blackness is to study self-hatred. But there are a lot of black people who don't hate being black. You see what I'm getting at? I don't hate being black, you know? So this questioning is what I'm talking about that's healthy. Now, I think Jean-Paul, the question you ask now brings up something very, very crucial. This is why you were absolutely correct, why I want to close with that question of power, because you all face this. I wrote an essay called On the Market Colonization of Intellectuals. And this is where knowledge and even politics become commodities, okay? And when you are dealing with the market commodification of knowledge, we're dealing with the effort to force everything in line with the power dynamics of market forces. So what often happens with disciplines is that they are asked not to articulate a relationship to reality, but to articulate a relationship to marketability. You see? And this effort for marketability then collapses into what's called power networks of knowledge. And these power networks, I also do work in sociology, as you could probably guess, in the sociology of knowledge, that because even though my PhD is in philosophy, because I never write starting with the premise of being a philosopher, I've been fortunate that my writings, because I address the problems, are read in different disciplines. So here's a big difference. I have colleagues, say, not in my department right now, but I've known colleagues who, if their book is not placed in their discipline, they're insulted. Do you see what I'm getting at? Because they're trying to make it as a political scientist or as an anthropologist. My books have been placed in psychology, philosophy, religion, education, history. They've been placed all over the place. Some have been read in psychology, natural science, in theoretical work in the sciences. Never insulted. The reason is because I take the position that what I'm trying to articulate is to communicate with other people pursuing knowledge. And if they find the work useful to build their knowledge on it, then they're taking it in a direction I may not have expected. And so my response, when it's located somewhere else, is to read how they're reading it to learn from it, you see? Now, the teleological question, of course, is I'm not dealing with teleology with the big T. It is not the idea of a complete universe and complete knowledge. I'm dealing with teleology in the sense of purpose within a particular social framework. In other words, every knowledge practice has to start somewhere. So, for many people, whatever discipline you start with is the discipline into which you must stay, remain, behave, be good. I take the position the discipline you start with is what you use to reach out to engage into a larger discourse. And once that larger discourse emerges, it may actually produce a new set of relations, but the error is to think those new relations become the end of the practice. There's a difference between seeking, this is getting to the question of
what I call epistemic closure. The error, there's a difference when one is trying to produce knowledge to end a discourse, to, right? It's like that war model, who wins? And if one is producing knowledge to be the condition to overcome itself. In psychoanalytical terms, that's like the parent who understands that the next generation is to go beyond the parent. You see? And so they connect in many ways. If we begin to see our practice, our disciplinary practice, as the kind of power that facilitates the production of new relations versus the kind of power that is like the father who closes off relations. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyway, I hope that's useful.
Yes, it is.